Hey everyone, Eber here with hardwarecanucks, and I'm here in LA attending E3, and I just finished my briefings with AMD about a bunch of stuff, including Zen 2, the Ryzen 3000 series processors, and the upcoming Navi-based graphics cards. Now, I will be covering Ryzen 3000 in a separate video because we do have a lot more information regarding the architecture and what AMD has brought to the table with the new offerings, so definitely stay tuned for that. But right now, I think the most important announcements are the graphics cards, the RX 5700 XT and the RX 5700, which will be available to buy later this summer. But will they be enough to give NVIDIA some competition? Well, we now know a lot more information about these new GPUs, so let's take a closer look. But first, a quick word from our sponsor.
Excuse me, please explain.
This is easy.
Two systems fully powered by a single power supply.
Oh.
Just like me and you.
Two bodies powered by a single mind.
Just imagine the good we can do.
The Revolt X by Fantex, a high performance unit for multi CPU, GPU, and dual system configurations with 80 plus platinum efficiency with entirely silent fan mode, a 12 year warranty, and clean cable management. Explore the opportunities with the Revolt X PSU by Fantex. Links below.
Okay, so before I get into the specs of these new GPUs, I think it's important to understand the underlying architecture of these new GPUs, and that's Radeon DNA, or RDNA. And for those of you who are wondering, it's based off a brand new 7-nanometer manufacturing process. The name RDNA actually gives a good hint at how AMD's approaching this generation of graphics cards. So instead of being the jack of all trades, which are great for everything from deep learning algorithms to gaming, there's laser focus on just gaming this time. Meanwhile, the Vega architecture will stick around for, high performance computing tasks and machine learning algorithms. Basically, RDNA is meant as a solution for an entire product stack that will include, everything from graphics processors to PCs to smartphones to notebooks to consoles and a lot more. So the first thing that AMD went about doing is optimizing power consumption versus performance. You see, while Vega did provide relatively good frame rates, it was super power hungry and it produced a lot of heat. Of course, the 7-nanometer manufacturing process helps with overall efficiency, but there's some extra special sauce added to RDNA as well. So there's reduced latency across the entire core, which increases bandwidth for better use of resources, and pipeline optimizations, which generate pretty big performance per clock improvements. Those will eventually lead to each chip providing better performance than Vega, but at lower power needs. When all of these items are combined, things start to look pretty impressive. AMD has also designed a new compute unit which theoretically doubles the instruction rate, since two of those CPUs can be combined to work on the same task in parallel. Within each compute unit are 64 stream processors. That means a full Navi 10 GPU with 40 compute units will have 2560 cores, which is much lower than the 4096 found on the Vega 64. So what does that result in? Well, from an apples-to-apples comparison, RDNA and the Navi architecture will have a 25% improvement over Vega when compared at the same core layout and clock speeds. Meanwhile, the full Navi 10 GPU found on these new cards will have about 14% better performance than Vega 64 while consuming much less power. That's actually pretty interesting, since Vega has a lot more compute units than Navi 10. But maybe the most amazing thing is how small the Navi 10 GPU actually is. Instead of it being 495 square millimeters, it's just 251, which is really, really impressive. So now let's get onto the actual specs of these cards. And yes, there will be two of them. Let's start at the top with the RX 5700 XT, which uses the full Navi 10 core. It has 2560 stream processors and operates with a base frequency of 1605 MHz and a game clock of 1755 MHz. Now, the game clock is basically what AMD expects will be achieved while gaming, while the boost speed of 1905 MHz now seems to be a target that very few applications will hit. There's also 8GB of GDDR6 memory that interfaces with a GPU via a 256-bit interface that hits 14Gbps per second of raw speed. Meanwhile, it has 256 texture units and 64 ROPs, and according to AMD, it has a board power of 225 watts, or about the same as an overclocked RTX 2080 Founders Edition. The RX 5700 uses a cut-down Navi 10 core with a slightly lower amount of stream processors compared to the XT variant and lower clock speeds of 1465 MHz and 1625 MHz for the base and game frequencies. Other than that, it has the same memory, texture units, and ROP layout as its bigger brother. Personally, I think this will be a sweet spot, even though its 180 watts of power puts it even higher than the RTX 2070. And both of these cards will be launching in July. So now let's take a look at the card itself. And there are a couple of things that jumped out to me personally. First of all, it is a blower style heatsink, which makes me think right away of the super loud reference AMD cards from the last 5 years or so. There's also 8 plus 6 pin power inputs and connectors for DisplayPort 1.4 and HDMI 2.0. The Radeon team also made a big deal about the PCI 4.0 interface, but there likely won't be any practical uses for that in the foreseeable future. I think it's just simply a marketing checkbox that they wanted to tick. Now, as for the overall performance, honestly, guys, don't expect flagship frame rates here. What AMD showed was a bunch of charts that tended to raise more questions than actually answering them. So starting with this one, which compared the RX 5700 XT to the Vega 56, and considering AMD spent most of their time talking about Vega 64, seeing Vega 56 was a bit odd, but well, at least it's Navi 10 with its 40 compute units that can easily outperform a Vega with 56 compute units. That's progress, I guess. Moving on, AMD did show some very straightforward performance numbers as well. Now, these show that the RX 5700 XT outperforming the RTX 2070 by an average of about 6%. At first glance, that's good news, but it also points towards the Radeon lineup slipping further behind Nvidia, since they're not even close to competing against the RTX 2080, not to mention the 2080 Ti. Not only that, but we can't forget that the RX 5700 XT has a board power of 225 watts, whereas the reference RTX 2070 is about 175 watts. And I guess that makes sense because AMD is targeting a larger market with the RX 5700 XT and the 5700. And if you think about it, most people aren't really particularly interested in the higher end GPUs like the RTX 2080 and the 2080 Ti, but rather, you know, they'd lean towards the RTX 2060 and the 2070, and most likely the GTX 1660 Ti as well. Personally, I'd love to see more competition in that area compared to some of the extreme ends. That's just my take. Now, the RX 5700 could be the new budget king if these results are anything to go by. As you can see, they're supposed to beat the RTX 2060 in literally every test, and even though it consumes more power, I'm getting more and more excited about what it can offer. But what do you guys think? Do you think this card is for you? Now, what about ray tracing? Honestly, that's a question less and less people are asking, and AMD is taking a pragmatic approach to it. Right now, their implementation is simple shader-based ray tracing without actual hardware acceleration. But as you probably heard in yesterday's Microsoft presentation, the next generation Project Scarlet console will include a Navi GPU and hardware-based real-time ray tracing acceleration when it launches in 2020. That means it will use the next generation RDNA and Navi architecture that will not only include hardware acceleration, but will also leverage cloud-based resources to optimize ray tracing performance. Speaking of those next generation of RDNA, you can expect to see RDNA 2 launch alongside next generation consoles in 2020, and it'll use a refined 7 nanometer process. There's no word on what that will mean for the PC market, but I wouldn't be surprised to see if it makes an appearance in 2021 or very late 2020. Remember, guys, that's more than a year from now, so anything could change by then. So I guess it's time to wrap this up. And guys, what AMD has shown isn't super exciting, but these new cards do look like they will hit very important markets. You see, the RTX 2060 and the RTX 2070 don't have any competition right now. So, you know, any alternatives will be a welcoming addition. But let's get this off the table right away. At this point, AMD has no plans to launch a GPU that will compete against the best of what NVIDIA has to offer. You see, their focus with RDNA, RDNA 2, and Navi is to offer, you know, console and smartphone manufacturers an efficient GPU architecture that will fit their needs. So they'll take that design and scale it upwards to create, you know, entry-level to mid-tier graphics cards for the PC market. So while AMD claims that their focus is on PC gamers, Navi's DNA is obviously rooted in the console space, and I don't think that's a bad thing either. So overall, I think there's a lot to look forward to when these new GPUs launch sometime next month. So definitely stay tuned for the reviews. But in the meantime, let us know your thoughts about the RX 5700 XT, the 5700, Navi. Man, it looks like every year or as generations go by, the naming scheme just gets even more complicated. So yeah, Let me know what you guys think. I'm Ibor with Hardware Canucks. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to check out some relevant content over here. Subscribe to our Boot Sequence channel. I'm signing off, and I'll see you guys in the next one.